My name is Danilo Gakhovchenko, and I'm working for Exact Pro, and I'm a part of a non-functional testing team. I specialize in the testing of complex post-trade systems, and currently our team is in charge of testing of quite complex clean platform. 2 years ago, our system was released into production, but it's still changing, and we continue testing it. Daily life cycle of any modern post-trade system is quite complex. It usually consists of several stages, which are a sequence of activities, which follow some business logic. At the same time, such systems have to process inbound transactions, generate outbound transactions, and et cetera. In other words, such systems have to perform various activities at the same time. So here on this slide, we try to show complexity of our testing system. So here in this picture, each square represents a particular component in our system. So we are more than 200 running such components in our system, which are deployed over 30 servers. Also, there are more than 100 scheduled activities, which are executed daily. So during our testing, we often observe problems with them. For example, they can get stuck for hours or unexpectedly fail. So such problems create delays for business activities which are executed after the failed ones. Of course, our team has a monitoring system to track such problems. And it's possible to say if a particular event runs longer than usual. After this, it is required to find the root cause. But the main problem is here, it happens only after the incident occurs. So we decided to check how we can optimize such process. Ideally, we wanted to predict any deviation and outages before they happen. To do so, we took a closer look on one of the type of logs which our system produces. It's components telemetry logs. As I said before, there are more than 200 running components in the system, and all of them produce such logs. So they contain information about the component's internal state. They updated each second and published to the text file. It's a really huge amount of data, about 30 gigabytes of data daily. So we decided to use machine learning techniques to process such data and get the results. So generally speaking, we have a task of some outage prediction based on previous activities. Such tasks can be applied to the different spheres. For example, we found a few examples related to automotive, banking ATMs, and other spheres. The most impressive results in all of these works were achieved by using the traditional machine learning techniques like random forest regression models. So we decided to try them first in our work. So now let's talk about the data. There are two sources where we got it. So the first one is a data set describing scheduled events in our system. So each of such event can be described by using the following attributes. So it's a unique identifier, type of activity, start time, end time, and completion status. So on this plot, we can see a distribution of durations for all activity types. So also in this picture, we can see an example of what our regular business day looks like. So here on the x-axis, we have a whole timeline of our regular business day. And on y-axis, we have a different activities which are executed in our system. So as we can see from this picture, some of the activities are executed only once a day, some of them are executed several times a day. So another source of data is telemetry logs. As I said before, there are more than 200 components, and all of them produce such logs. So here at the top of this slide, we can see a representation of what such logs look like. So it basically it is not structured textual information where each component has its own parameters and own format of data. So the first problem that we had to solve, we need to create a structured data set for all of these parameters. Another problem which we faced with these logs was its size. So during our testing, we collected hundreds of gigabytes of logs for the last 2 years. So here we needed to process such huge amount of data in easy to use data set. To do so, we chose standard comma separated file format, where each column was a particular parameter from telemetry logs, and each line represented a particular time on the timeline. So such approach allowed us not only to structure the data, but also reduce size of log by 93%. However, the amount of parameter wasn't changed, and we still had about 7,500 parameters, which are updated each second. So at this point, we had two unlinked data set. First one of reasonable size of activities, and a really big one for telemetry logs. Hence, each event, for each event, we have one row from activity data set and multiple lines from telemetry logs. It is because of each particular event lasts at least a few seconds. And for exactly the same period of time, we needed to collect telemetry logs of 7,500 parameters. So it's a really such a really huge size of data doesn't allow us to work with it easily, just because of we don't need enough hardware resources. So we decided to try to find a way how we can reduce its size. And we decided to replace parameter vector update to a set of values describing how such particular parameter was updated. To this, we used aggregate functions. We started with most obvious ones like a minimum, maximum, and average values. So instead of the vector, let's say 1,000 parameters, we got just 3. Of course, we lose some data here, but we significantly reduce size of logs. After joining activity data set and new telemetry data set, we got a really wide table. But it was still possible to remove correlated columns and columns with constant values. So here on the right of this slide, we can see a full processing data pipeline, which we used. So such approach allowed us to significantly reduce size of logs and get the dataset easy to use for the modeling. Final size of the table was still big, but it was about 2,500 parameters. But it was much, much smaller than we had before. So now let's move forward to our research results. At the very beginning of our research, we decided to evaluate the duration for just one activity type. So here, in this case, the telemetry data was taken from first to the second to the last second of one particular activity. And using the decision tree regressor model, we got the following results. So here, on the x-axis, we have a different runs of one particular activity sorted by real duration value. And on the y-axis, we have a duration in seconds. As the main metric to assess precision of our models, we chose root mean square error. It's the basic metric to estimate precision for regression for all regression models which we used in our work. So in all further experiments, we used the same metric as well. So as we can see, such results was unacceptable for us. But we see one positive thing here. So there is a correlation between the real value and predicted value. So, and well, longer activities have a bigger RMSE as well. Also, as our main goal of our research is to create a solution to predict duration for the varied number of activities, the way to create a single model for each activity doesn't seem feasible. So we decided to create a single model to predict duration for all activity type. So here on this slide, we can see first results of our task. So such results were not good for us, as we can see from this plot. And it needed to be improved. To increase the model performance, we decided to normalize the target value using the logarithm function instead of absolute values. As we can see on this plot, it allowed us to improve our performance. So here, the red curve shows the results before normalization, and blue lines shows results after normalization. Also, during all our experiments, we could see that the longer activities produced the bigger RMSE if we measure it in seconds, even if for short activities everything was fine. So to fix it, we decided to recalculate our metric using the following formula. So here in this case, our metric was calculated in relation to the target value and it's measured in seconds. So it allowed us to reduce a gap between duration of short and long activities. And as a result, all activities contribute to the RMSE value equally. So after these changes, we compared the performance of decision tree and random forest regressor models. So as you can see on this plot, in the most cases, the performance of random forest models was significantly better. So here on this slide, on the y-axis, we have percentages, not seconds, which we had in previous experiments. On the x-axis, we have a number of runs of model for the same initial dataset. So up until now, we compared the performance. So we predicted the performance using the data from the beginning till the end of the duration of event. But the actual business scenario is to predict any deviations before workflow is finished. So here we decided to create three additional datasets with 25, 50, and 75% of initial data. So for example, if the duration of such particular event was 10 seconds, for 25% dataset, we took telemetry logs just for first 2.5 seconds. Then we compared results for these three datasets. So the results can be seen on this slide. Actually, we didn't see any improvements. It didn't see quality improvement here, and the performance was at almost the same level as for the models trained at 100 percent point. After this, we wanted to check one more thing. We just joined all three above datasets into one with one additional column indicating at what point data was collected. After this, the model was trained using the same approach, and as we can see on this slide, the performance was significantly better. So this is the main result of our work. So at the end of this presentation, I would like to sum up our main achievements which we got during the research. So at first we found the approach to prepare the dataset of reasonable size. Also, we developed an approach for data augmentation. Also, our experiments shown that a random forest regressor model predicts activity with acceptable performance, but still there is a room for improvement here. And a couple words about our future work. So as we get some results for activity-based dataset, we would like to prove that the similar performance can be reached for a time-based dataset. Also, we would like to try to find other ways for data aggregation to get better model performance, and also find out how much data we need to start acceptable prediction in production runs. And after we get the acceptable results, we would like to focus on explanation of failures of our activities based on the telemetry logs which we had. So that's all. Thank you for your attention.